Hola, y'all. What is that? That's a deer. That scared me. It's a deer in my yard eating acorns. All the wildlife are coming out. It is incredibly late. So late that I'm not even gonna tell you how late it is. I've had a great day. Celebrating Ava Dawn's birthday. Remember I told you yesterday that we were going to continue today, and we went to altitude, her and her friends. We took them to altitude to jump on the trampolines and play for a while. And then I took her to eat her favorite food at one of her favorite restaurants, which is wings. Sorry about that. My phone is about to die. I took her to get some fried chicken wings because my baby loves some fried chicken wings. And took two of her friends with us, and they said they had never had Wingstop. And one of them got chicken strips, and the other little girl said she had never eaten wings with bones in them ever. And I said, well, today's the day, sis. Today is the day you're gonna learn to eat wings like a big girl. I said, I'm gonna teach you how to eat wings off a bone. I'm sure her mom is going to be so proud. So we went, and she went to start taking the chicken wing and tearing it off. And I said, no, 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 no. You grab that chicken wing and you bite it and you get the meat off and you clean it. You get in between all them bones. And she loved it. Anyway, I told her, I said, it has more flavor. The bones, more flavor. Juicy, more flavor. So, had a good time, went and got him some ice cream, came back home, had to run my son to a concert to catch his ride to go to a concert with the church. And so, I've just been running around like crazy. Y'all, tonight is the night for noises, I guess, because there's gunshots. Anyway, and that's concerning, considering how late it is. So it's been a long day. I've been working on the blog and doing some other things. And didn't get any of it finished. But that's neither here nor there. Okay. Get into it. Well, I was reading in Ezekiel. I think it's chapter 13, 14. I read a piece of both chapters. And one chapter is dealing with false prophets, and the other chapter is dealing with idolaters. And I thought, my word, what is this? Not that I haven't read it before or anything, but I usually like to talk to you guys about, you know, what I read. And, I was thinking, well, yesterday I just talked to him about, or a couple days ago, talked to him about broken miracles and all of that. And bam, we just hit up some false teachers and lying. And so I'm going to paraphrase. I read the latter portion of chapter 13, I believe, and into chapter 14. I didn't finish all of chapter 14. It was just a good chunk of it. So I'm just going to tell you what it said. And maybe we can just briefly talk about it, and then I can make my way inside and take a bath and get into bed in this very, I was going to say ungodly hour, but it's not ungodly because God is out here walking with me. But it is incredibly late. The latter end of, I believe, 13 talks about God's people being lied to by leadership. The name of the chapter in my Bible is False Prophets, so it would be obviously religious leaders. The portion that I read was saying that they prophesy out of their own heart. So they say how what they think and how they feel about things and not what God thinks and what God feels. And that he goes on to just tell him how incredibly angry he was about that. And I thought it was interesting wording at the end of that chapter. He says, he's telling Ezekiel to prophesy to them. So he's sending them a message through Ezekiel, and he's very angry. And he says, you tell them that they have lied to my people and they have made my people sad. And I didn't make my people sad. They made my people sad with their lies. Why does that strike me as odd? Because I was thinking, it's just interesting that God is saying, my people are sad. And I didn't make them sad. What the things that I do for them and what I'm doing, the life I'm giving them is not something to make them sad about. But your lies have made them sad. God is concerned about his people, and he was concerned about people over those people who were not honest or faithful or being truthful and making those people sad. And he goes on to say that the same people, this false prophet, whoever he's talking to, these leaders, these false prophets of the children of Israel, it said, you make my people sad, but then you strengthen the hand of the wicked so that he has no fear of life, of losing his life, but actually of reward. And I was like, man alive, that sounds like dirty dealings. What is the deal with dirty dealings? And here God is talking to Ezekiel saying, look, there's these religious leaders among my people prophesying things I never said, talking about things I never approved of, but they're not good things. First of all, they're not true things, and that's the most important thing. You don't want to prophesy fake good news either, because if it's not what God said, you're a false prophet. You're not prophesying at all. You're lying in the name of the Lord. And he's saying they're prophesying out of their own heart. I didn't tell them any of this. But what they're telling my people is making my people sad and dejected and lonely. So these lies aren't even building up the people. It's lies that hurt my people. My righteous people is what he calls them. Making my righteous people sad. He said, but the same lies are building up the evil people. And providing a place for them to flourish, not just survive, but they have no worry of losing anything. They are gaining. And God was not happy. And he goes on in that chapter to tell exactly what he was going to do to those false prophets, exactly how he was going to handle that lying spirit that was making righteous people sad. And then it's like, it starts a new chapter, so I guess it's okay to go, well, we're just going to talk about something else. But he does. He jumps right into the next chapter, and it says that like an elder of the children of Israel comes to sit down before Ezekiel. I believe it's before Ezekiel. I don't think it's in front of one of those prophets. But God begins to talk about them having idols set up in their hearts. And I am severely paraphrasing here. You can definitely go read it. I'm not making it up. I just cannot remember all of the wording because it's quite wordy. It was a lot. And when God gets mad in the scripture and he spends an entire chapter, two chapters, three chapters getting on to people and saying, look, this isn't going to work, it can start to sound the same, even though it's not. But this was all about having idols in your heart. They've set up idols in their heart. Okay? And the big deal about that is nobody knows that except God. Kind of like the false prophet situation. I mean, it does say that we can test a prophet and see if they're telling the truth or not. Because if what they say doesn't come to pass, mark them. They're not prophets of the Lord. But while it's happening, you know, if, I mean, if they don't prophesy something to happen for a long time, you have to wait on that. I guess in the waiting, you don't know where you're at. You don't know if it's real or not, or you trust that it is. And that, you know, if it was something bad, that's what's making the righteous people sad or whatever. You get what I'm saying. All right, well, the heart is the same way. God is the only one that can see it. And he's the only one that can see if we've got idols stacked up high inside of it too. And idols look like lots of different things. I have heard it super simplified. For example, idols are anything that you put in front of God. Anything that you value more than your relationship with God. And I think where it can get iffy for us is in our brains, we think, I don't have an idol. I don't put anything in front of the Lord, right? Because we definitely don't bow down and worship anything, you know, like a statue or a person or a spirit other than the Lord. And so I think it's easy for us to go, well, I don't have idols in my heart. I'm not an idol worshiper. I don't do that. And I don't think we do those insane or super outward manifestations of idol worship. But he wasn't talking about outward manifestations of idol worship in this chapter. He was talking about a profound number of idols set up in their hearts. And that's all he talked about. He didn't talk about the real idols in the room. Matter of fact, we don't even know if there were real ones. He simply said, there's a lot of idols in their hearts and I see it. And then he goes to say, when they come to inquire of me and talk to me, when they come to inquire from these false prophets who are telling lies, I will deal with them by the number of false idols in their hearts. Yeah. So we may be fooling the people around us. They can't see our hearts. They can't see the shelves with all the trophies that have our names on them. Me, 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 me. I. Mine, 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 mine. Money, 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 money. Vanity, 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 vanity. Pride, pride, pride. Prejudice, prejudice. Racism, racism. Sexism, sexism. Abuse. We don't have access to the shelves of the hearts of men. And thank goodness we don't, because that's a matter between the Lord and a person. But do you know who does have access? God. Still aiming for that 15-minute mark. I'm almost done. I want him to come in and sweep, clean house. Because God said, you know, we may fool people down here. We may, because we can hide those rooms in the heart. We can hide them. Those selfish ambitions, those lofty goals that are really like temples of pride that we have really, really cemented. We've laid a foundation. We've built walls. We've made these houses 2 and 3 stories in our hearts. Our accomplishments. The things that we've done to acquire greatness and wealth, prestige. And idols have a lot of different things. Idols can be people too. Some people put relationships in front of God. Some people put marriages in front of the Lord, in front of his will. Some people put their children in front of God. Some people don't follow God's will because of family members. Those are idols. No, the people aren't idols, but when you slap that relationship in front of the Lord, he's not happy. He didn't give Abraham a pass. Sacrifice your one and only son to me. Will you do it? Because if you won't, you're not mine. If you're not willing, I should come first. And that's what God says, but not in a rude way. He is number one. He is. was there before you got married. He created you. He saw you before you breathed your first breath. He was there before those children were born. They're only there because of him. He was there to give you that job, that the one that you miss your dedicate, you know, your church for, the one that you don't, you know, idol worship. And idols aren't always gold statues. And they're built pretty easily, quickly and effortlessly, because the world is standing by to hand you materials just to do that. Just to do it. You know why? Because Satan is the prince of the air down here, and he does have a moment of time on the planet that he does have power. Not stronger than us, not stronger than God, but he's running free right now to deceive, to trip up, to harm, to whatever he can do to get as many people to go to hell with him as he can. And we cannot be ignorant of his devices. And so, yes, he is on standby to try to hand you anything, to put anything in your hand so that you will build some idols in your heart. He doesn't really care if they manifest outside, because God's looking on the heart. They do manifest on the outside. Anything on the inside eventually comes out on the outside. But I'm just saying, he's there to hand you some tools to go and set up. And the sad part is, like I said, God said, I will deal with every man according to the number of idols he's built up in his heart. That's how I'll answer him when he comes to me. And then he says, when one of these people comes to inquire, one of these false prophets, first of all, I will cut him off. I will cut him off from my people. But then he said, I won't even go through the false prophet. I will talk to him all by myself. God is pretty angry. That chapter continues, but I'm done. I don't want no idols in my heart. And I'm going to play a song. It's an old song. I love this song. It invites God into the heart. The heart. We need God in the home. We need God in the workplace. We need God in the church. We need God in our cars. We need God everywhere. But the truth is, we can be in all of those places. And in our heart, it can be black as night. And we can have all types of idols set up. We can have good-looking houses. We can have Bibles on every nightstand. We can have crosses hanging from our rearview mirrors. Bumper stickers of our church. We can have pictures of Jesus on Calvary in the office. It doesn't matter. And are those things bad? Absolutely not. But they're not the heart. And none of that stuff will matter if the heart's not right. No idols, no idols, no idols. Go read it. Go read it. Go read Ezekiel 13:14. And listen to this song, because it is really good. It's called Welcome Home. And it's talking about God making his home inside of our hearts. And that's where I want him. Happy Saturday.
Welcome to this heart of mine, buried under prideful lies, grown to hide the mess I've made inside of me. Come decorate, Lord, and open up the creaking door, and walk upon the dusty floor. Scrape away the guilty stains until no sin or shame remain. Spread your love upon the walls and occupy the empty halls until the man I am has faded. No more doors are barricaded.